I would like to talk about being a woman in the field of STEM, and STEM in this instance meaning science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. So I want to share my story as Lara has just been reading a brief summary of my CV. I think I just want to take the audience to who I am, where I come from, and show the audience really that I'm just an ordinary individual. There's really nothing special about me. I'm just as ordinary as people come. But I think through the necessary support, I have managed to progress quite well in my career and in the field of STEM. And I'm just going to share my story so that the audience can maybe relate and also can just pick up that, it doesn't matter what you're going through. It could sometimes be things that I'm also going to share from my side that you pick up as similarities in your own journey. I want you not to be deterred by what you are going through as a woman in STEM or a potential woman in STEM, but just to, keep your foot on the pedal and just keep going, because life throws different things to us, but or on us. We should not be fazed. We should just, take those sometimes and use them as our stepping stones. So that's why I named today's talk as "You Too Can Be a Woman in STEM." And I'd like to wish all the women in online a happy Women's Month. In South Africa, August is our Women's Month, and as Lara said, Friday is our international, or rather our Women's Day in South Africa. So yeah, maybe let's just get acquainted. Who is Patience? So I was born and raised by a single parent. That's my mother right there. I want to see if I can try to find a pointer. Yes, pointer options, laser pointer. So that's my mother. My mother had me in 1976, and that's me at 6 months. And she raised me as a single parent. And I don't want to get into the story of how that became or how that came to be, but I just want to say, if you are out there, you are a young girl, you have been raised by a single parent, it's nothing to it's not unusual. You can still be successful, okay? So my mother actually raised me with the help of my grandmother and my aunts. So especially my mother's young sister, my mother's youngest sister was a teacher, and most of my life as a young girl I spent that time with my mother's aunt, my mother's sister, sorry, my aunt, and she became my mentor as well. So I remember when she would get up in the mornings, like at the crack of dawn, to study, I would get up with her. Little did I know that that habit would actually stick with me for the rest of my life. So, as I said, that was me at 6 months. And then when it came to schools and high schools, I attended primary school. And because my mother didn't stay with me and she didn't have a house of her own, I attended primary school in schools in Soweto, so government schools, and I attended about four different primary schools. So, like jumping and chopping from one school to another, because we would move with my mother. So that also created a little bit of instability. But when I went to high school, I went to high school in Riashuma. It was a new school in Protea North, in Soweto, for those that are familiar with the structures in South Africa. And I remember I was in the class of 94, and we had a 100% pass rate. And because I was a curious person as a child, I still am, I was studying the sciences at Riashuma. So following Riashuma, I had a gap year because I really didn't know what to do in 1995. So in 96, I then was introduced to the Rand Afrikaans University. Actually, I applied for university in 95 for different institutions. So I applied for the University of Witwatersrand, which is Wits. I applied at the University of Cape Town, and I applied at RAU, which is this university. And I was accepted in all three places. But my mother said, definitely not UCT because it's too far. She can't keep an eye on me. And she would like to still be part of my life, even though I'm at university. And then the choice was now down to vets or rao. And at the time, it's fine now, but at that time, there were a lot of riots at vets university. And my mother said, no, you're not going to be able to go to a place where there's a lot of disruptions in terms of academic year. So it was down to rao. Now, my challenge with rao was the fact that rao was an Afrikaans institution at the time, and I was registered for the sciences, and I was accepted for the sciences. But now I knew that the textbooks, the lectures, the study guides, everything was in Afrikaans. So what I literally had to do during my first 3 years at rao would be to translate everything from Afrikaans to English, and then only study when my notes were now, in a better state of understanding that was like now in English. So I would do that all the time. That would like consume so much of my time, but it worked out. I told myself I'm not going to disappoint my mother, who was working so hard to make sure that I get university education while she didn't. So I had to stick it up and just make sure that, RAU works. And yeah, it worked. I mean, I studied all the way up until master's level at RAU. And I then left in 2002. That was my last year. So at the end of that year, I left, and I was fortunate enough to have gotten a position at the National Institute for Communicable Diseases. And at the time, I was doing research in HIV because there was so many deaths at around that time, like mid-90s to late-90s, early 2000s, of the people that were dying from HIV AIDS, and I wanted to be part of the scientific group that's leading the solution for this monster that was killing. I mean, a lot of my high school friends passed away because of HIV. So I wanted to be part of the solution. So I then joined the NICD, and they had a big HIV unit, and I did beautiful research there. But what frustrated me working for the NICD at the time was that I was on contract work, so I didn't have a permanent position. And the contract was only going to be renewed every year, depending on the availability of funds to actually keep us. So I thought, no, I don't want to be in that environment because I wanted to have job stability. I heard of the CSIR, and I started applying for a job. And in 2004, I was accepted in both the Modderfontein campus and the CSIR Pretoria campus. And I had to make a choice which one was going to be the place I go for work. The Modderfontein was again a contract, so they, although they were promising that it was a renewable contract every year, so because of that contract status, I decided I was going to join the CSIR in Pretoria, which was now a permanent job opportunity. The challenge there was that I was coming in as a medical biochemist. So I was more in the biological sciences sphere and not necessarily in the physical sciences. And the placement at CSIR Pretoria was at the Photonics Center. And everybody there was a physicist. So they were looking for somebody to start their biophotonics area. And this was now in 2004. So that challenge was thrown at me, and they asked me to basically start their biophotonics research within their center. So because I wasn't qualified at the time and I wasn't a physicist myself, I started looking around in the country for universities where I could study biophotonics, and there was nothing. And then I remember a colleague of mine saying to me, let's go to conferences, and then maybe you can identify potential supervisors at a conference. And lo and behold, we went to a biophotonics summer school in Sweden, and that this is now in 2005. That was around their summertime, which was June in 2005. And I met a fellow there called Professor Kishan Dulakia, who was based at the University of St. Andrews, which is the southeast area there in Scotland. And at the time, I think I didn't really understand what work he was doing. But fortunately, that same year, I went to another conference, an international conference in August. This was now in San Diego. And I met the same guy again. This time, he had brought his whole group that was presenting at a conference there, the SPIE conference. Those in photonics would be maybe aware of it. And they were presenting their work in optical trapping. I found it so fascinating, and I was so taken aback as to how you can use optics and photonics to actually manipulate live cells and, add things into cells. You can add other molecules into cells just using light, and you can move a cell and separate healthy cells from disease cells using optical trapping. And I thought, this is what I want to do for my PhD. That's how I then registered with my then supervisor, Professor Kisha Ndulakia, at the University of St. Andrews to go and do my PhD. And I started my PhD in 2006. And St. Andrews on a fine day would be, you can take beautiful photos. It's a very small town, by the way, very intimate. And you could see the university is very old. And this was university town, basically, but there was two communities that you would find: the university students and the elderly that were, staying there, like the Scottish locals that were staying there. Very safe, very serene. I mean, very different from what I knew in South Africa. It was a place where I could stretch myself. My supervisor also advised me that, for me to make it for a PhD, I would need to take some lectures in physics. So I took, while I was doing my PhD, I was also doing my master's in physics for non-degree purposes. So, and my supervisor also told me, you would need maybe to teach first year physics so that you can get the fundamentals, or you can remind yourself of the fundamentals. So I would teach like physics laboratories, and as well as, some tutorials to first year students so that I could get my physics up to scratch again. So you can see that during my PhD years, really, I was not living, I was merely existing, because all I did was work. But the place was allowing. I think the St. Andrews is also called the home of golf. And in the summer and during the golf season, you would bump against, the likes of Tiger Woods. And in 2010, I actually graduated with my PhD in physics. And I was so proud, because here I was, raised by a single parent from Soweto, and switching disciplines and then coming and getting my PhD in record time was just something that was just mind-boggling for me. So, it showed me that if I set anything in front of me, I can really go for it. So, and never mind my skimpy outfit, that was real snow. I wanted to take pictures in the snow so that I can remind myself of the beauty of, being in Europe. Their winters are really very cold. So, yeah, that was, my undergraduate, postgraduate life. And then now the task at hand was to come back and do what I was employed for by the CSIR, which is starting the biophotonics facility. And this was the first laboratory, the first optics laboratory that I set up when I came back after my PhD. I managed to get some research funding, and I got that lab. I had already had a cell culture lab. And I at the time, it was just the two labs, the cell culture lab and the optics lab that we were using. And that was one of my first students. And then this was my first group when we started. This was when we went to a conference in 2017. So at the time, we were doing optical trapping and we were doing all sorts of research. And you will see also how the research also evolved, because firstly, when you do research in South Africa, you must make sure that it's research that's supported by industry. You can get an industry partner that can later maybe even adopt the technologies that you've developed. So the research that I was doing at the time really didn't attract too many industry partners, because a lot of industry partners did not see how they could apply it. So I had to evolve it a bit. And you will hear towards the end of my presentation how I evolved it, or to what I evolved it to. Secondly, in terms of fundability, you need to convince whoever is funding your research that the work that you are doing is worth funding, and the work that you are doing is going to emanate into proper impact and direct impact. Like it's research that's solving real life problems. So at that time, around 2012, I was still finding my feet as a researcher and figuring out what works in terms of attracting funding, as well as in terms of generating impact and in terms of, aligning with what is a need out there in industry and getting industry partners. So those are all the things I had to learn as a researcher and a young researcher. Okay, as Lara said, in terms of my career, I'm a TED fellow. I love participating in science, in popularizing science. And I found things like TED, and there's also what is known as Jive Media, where they you get taught to simplify your science to be able to communicate what a scientist does in layman's term without the jargon that we usually use as scientists, so that you can take everybody on board. It's important to be able to do that, because then you can talk to policymakers and they will be able to get you, and they will be able to tell if your work is, worth promoting and supporting, so it's very important. And that's why I got involved with TED. But I also do a lot of interviews, where I talk about my life, but not only that, I also talk about the science that I do. So that was one of the clips from an interview that's also online. Because I also spend my time with high scholars, I love spending time with the youth. I think they keep me relevant as well. But I talk to them and, I help them with their physics, their mathematics. When a school in Soweto, which is a school of specialization, was opened in 2016, that picture there is on a block of on a building block, and it's their science building, and they put up that picture and named the that whole science block after me. So, if you go to that school, you will see this big portrait of me on their building of science. So because of my contribution to helping the community there, they also saw it fit to honor me. And then other highlights, as Lara just communicated, in 2012, I got the highest award in the country, which is the Order of Mapungubwe. And then these are just some of my awards. In 2022, I got CSIR Wide Human Capital Development Award, and I then got another award, which is Established Researcher within the cluster that I'm based in within the CSIR. And then last year, I got the South African Women in Science Awards, that's given by the Minister of Science. Again, this year, I got the NSTF Award, which is also given by the Minister. I make sure that it's not only my profile that's looking good where I am based at work. So you will also note that my team tends to, this is my team, they also tend to attract awards, whether it's from the CSIR or from internationally when they are presenting, or nationally in other conferences. And I make sure that especially if my PhD students are graduating, I attend their graduations. So this was us, I think this was in 2021 when two of my PhDs were graduating in UNISA, and then another PhD of mine graduated in 2023 at UKZ. And so my students are also based in universities around the country, because I don't belong to a university. CSIR isn't a university, but we keep university students on a full-time basis and make sure that they are registered with universities that can confer degrees on them. Lebohang, who was graduating here, also got an award the same year that I got the best or established researcher award, as well as human capital researcher, or rather human capital development award. He got emerging researcher, and then the likes of Mkhape and the others really in my group always get awards when they go out and present our work. So it also keeps us in check, because it says the science that we do is good and the audiences out there acknowledge it. I usually also tell my team, we're not in this for getting awards, but if you work hard, your work will actually speak for itself and it will attract acknowledgement. So outside of the lab, I am also a married woman. This is my husband, McGregor. He is in the legal fraternity. He's an advocate. And yeah, we got married in 2020. 15, yes, it's 10 years next year. And because I love the sea, we got married. We had a beach wedding, which was very beautiful. I want to say that every woman that's married, especially if you are in the field of STEM, it is a big bonus if you have a supportive husband. My husband has been supporting me. One, you travel a lot. Two, you work. Sometimes, even if when I'm at home, I work very late nights. And, because my husband accommodates that and supports that, it makes it easy for me. So, I might appear as successful on the outside, but it wouldn't be possible if I wasn't getting all the support that I need from my home. And this is why I wanted to include such slides in my presentation. I am a mother as well, which makes it, very hard to also be a woman in STEM, but it's not impossible. I've got twin boys. This is them when they were, I think, 6 months, actually, 6 months. And this is them when they started preschool. And they are now 6 years. They just turned six. So again, with twins and a full-time job and a job that's so demanding, you really need to have a good support structure at home. And I must say, my family really provides that, which makes it easier for me to cope at work. I saw that because in 2018, I gave birth and I had to go on maternity leave. I took 6 months maternity leave because I just felt, I'm not going to take 4 months because I'm having two babies and I don't want to leave them back at home too soon after I've had them. So I took 6 months and I could see the type of dent that created in my career. It was very difficult to come back and, to pick off again, pick up and, hit the ground running again. But because of the support, again, of my family and my husband, it wasn't impossible. You saw all the awards I just showed you, aside from the one from 2012, were recent awards. And I'm not saying I work for awards, but, it just shows that even after motherhood, it's possible to be successful if you've got a supporting structure. So this is more family pictures of me and the twins and me and their dad. What I want to draw here is that draw your attention to here is that when I was 6 months, which is around the time these guys were 6 months in this picture, it was just me, my mother, and all the ladies in my mother's family. I didn't have a dad, but it's such a blessing to see that God has put a father in my children's life. I must tell the audience that in terms of marriage and dating and all of that, I was quite a late bloomer. I met my husband when I was 38, and even at that time, I wasn't sure whether when it comes to relationships, am I dating? Am I not dating? What am I going to do? But he was persistent, and he showed me that he wanted to be in my life until I started believing it slowly but surely. And today we are happy in marriage. So again, you don't have to be a particular type of candidate to be successful in STEM. Whether you're married, you're not married, whether you're a late bloomer or it doesn't matter. Well, I'm saying all these things to just try and show that life can be as ordinary can be. But if you want to be a woman in STEM, you just need to be determined, and with the necessary support, it can be done. With my university as well, I mean, with my supervisor that said to me, you need to make sure that you teach first year physics, you need to take our master's classes for non-degree purposes to be able to get a PhD in physics. When I was a biochemist at the time, I was able to switch disciplines because of the support that I had there. I must mention that when I studied at Rao, one of the professors in the physics class actually put me off slightly, off physics, and he said to me, Black people cannot do physics because Black people cannot see in three dimensions. And it was very difficult to be in Rao and to be around an environment that could be at times a bit hostile. But because my eye was not really in what was happening at the time, in what was people saying to me at the time, yes, of course, it put me off physics for a while. But when I was now placed in a position where there was a lot of support for me to do physics, I thrived in physics. So I know that there could be some people in the audience listening this afternoon, and maybe somebody who's your current supervisor, your current boss, whatever the case, has said things to you that make you want to sort of like limit yourself and put yourself in a box. Don't do it. You too can do it. You can be a woman in STEM, you can be a woman in physics or whatever. 2018 was a particularly bittersweet year because in as much as in April 2018, I was still pregnant, and then in May, I gave birth to my twins. My sister, who's standing next to me there, was still alive. That same year in August, my babies were barely 3 months. My sister passed away. So this year, the 1st of August, was actually 6 years since my sister passed away. I must say, you know, I'm dealing with it. And it's one thing that I feel was a trauma that has still impacted and is affecting my life to this day, because it was just the two of us. So, you know, grief is another damper. It can be another distractor to your career, but you can find ways of dealing with it in a way that you can still manage to keep your sanity and manage to help those around you and grow with them. So, you know, if you are going through grief, just keep that in mind. I know it's not cut out, all that cut out and dried and one size fits all, but find what works for you to deal with the space you're in, okay? In my case, I think my family, especially my children, they preoccupy me at times, and they make me to forget about, you know, some of the things that are, you know, could be challenges or problems in my head. I think also immersing myself in work helps me a lot to deal with things like grief in this case. Okay, now let's get back to my life at work. I work for the Council for Scientific and Industrial Research. As I said, I started working for them very young, in 2004. This year, actually, in October, I'll be 30 years within the CSIR. It doesn't feel like 30 years, though, because I have been in different ranks within the CSIR, and I have grown from rank to rank. So my work has been evolving in as much as I have stayed so long. So I'm not bored at the CSIR because I've managed to, you know, grow within different ranks, which have different work activities as well. This is the campus at the CSIR. My building is somewhere around here. We were called the National Laser Center, but now we are called the Photonics Center, and we deal with laser research. But there's a whole lot of research that is done within the CSIR. And if you are ever in South Africa, for those members of the audience that are not really based in South Africa, please come along. We've got research in energy, in water, in next gen health, in agriculture. We've got a big mining sector research that's happening, and we've got photonics, of course. As I've said, we've got defense, safety and security. So yeah, there's a lot of work. We've got the nano center within the campus. So yeah, I mean, it's a hub for different types of research, and we are happy to collaborate. So just hook us up if you are at the CSIR and come and see what we do. For me specifically, as I said, I'm at the Photonics Center, and the Photonics Center has got different areas of focus. We've got the Photonics Prototyping Facility. This is a facility that is used when you are about to commercialize a prototype. So this is for that stage of your product development where you are now commercializing. And it doesn't only belong to us that work here in the Photonics Center. It's a national facility for anybody in South Africa that wants to do commercialization of photonics products. And then we also have the Novel Lasers Group. This is a big group that's developing lasers within South Africa. And then we have the Biophotonics Group, which is my group. And I did say earlier that, you know, I adapted my research and I made sure that it's fundable, it makes direct impact, and it also attracts industry partners. So what I do now is the development of diagnostic tools for portable, low cost, as well as point of care. And I will touch more into that just now. Lara, how am I doing for time?
Okay. You're good.
Okay. All right. And then there's also the group. Sorry. Okay. Okay. There's also a group called the laser-enabled manufacturing. They do additive manufacturing. And this is a group that uses high-powered lasers that can also do 3D printing of titanium products and all sorts, really. They also do laser cutting for car parts and all of that. We've got the national programs which support high education institutions for with rental equipment, as well as the African Laser Center that provides research between South Africa as well as other African countries, like collaboration between other African countries and South African partners, and they can provide support for those groups. And then we also have the laser engineering services, which is like a small company within our center, you know, because they do a lot of implementation of laser manufacturing work in industry. So let's get into my biophotonics work that I do. Let's zoom in a bit. So biophotonics, as the word explains, it's applying photonics in understanding biology questions, or providing solutions using photonics, but that will be applied in the biology sector. So yes, right now I'm based at the CSIR, but eventually I would like to also spin off, like the company I was talking about that belongs to us. It's still with us, but you know, it could be a spin off anytime. I would like to spin off as a diagnostic company, and the brand name would be Ukukhanya Diagnostics. How do we come up with this? Ukukhanya is a Zulu word for light. When you use this Ukukhanya word as a verb, it means to shine. If you use it as a noun, it means brightness. So what we're basically saying here is that we shine light in any molecule. It could be a DNA molecule, it could be a chemical molecule, but once we've shone light onto that molecule, we are able to inform exactly the type of structure that molecule comprises of, okay? So we are using light, whether it's lasers or LEDs, whatever form of light, as long as it's photons and it can be mixed with optics, we are able to then look exactly into a structure of that, be it a biological molecule or a chemical molecule, and inform exactly what it is. And because of that novelty of research and that type of capability of research, it allows us to then act or work in the space of diagnostics. So the work that we do in biophotonics is very multidisciplinary in nature as well. So the facility itself, it's now four labs that are quite big. So we've got the biological lab, we've got the mammalian culture lab, we've got our molecular biology lab, and then we've got a big photonics lab that has got different photonics setups that we are putting together from scratch, and these allow us to do diagnostics. So we are playing in the field of photonics, but we also understand pathogens. So my group comprises virologists, molecular biologists, chemists, mathematicians. We've got a bit of everyone, because the work allows that we are doing requires that we have a mixture of disciplines, okay? Our eventual aim is to actually be able to make medical diagnostics. So we play across disciplines to get to a point where we can deliver diagnostics that can be taken to point of care. Okay, so applications, some of the work that we do have got applications in health. And really how that became a research activity for us, or an objective for us, was because I looked into a picture where diagnostics are done in a laboratory that is, you know, fully equipped, that has got all sorts of resources, and it even has a learned technician here that's running all sorts of equipment and to do diagnostics at the end of the day. And diagnostics are quite expensive. I mean, if you do a full blood count, it can set you back 2,000 rands, you know, in or a full blood test. It can set you back, you know, anything between About 2000 to 2800 rands, right, to just do that. And so that's very expensive, and the turnaround times can also be quite long. And for groups like this is in South Africa. It's quite interesting that you find different settings. You get very highly resourced hospitals, but then you also get groups of people that rely on this van as their local clinic, right? So this is a mobile clinic that's coming to this group of people, and it's an HIV clinic where this group in KwaZulu-Natal, which is one of the provinces in our country, have to go and do their diagnostics. Sometimes by the time they get here, having walked like miles or kilometers to even get here, the van has left. Or sometimes you find that, the van didn't come, whatever the case, but it's a problem. So what we want to do with the research that we do is put the laboratory, as you saw it in this picture, into a smartphone. So in about 2 years, 2 years ago, the phone was actually being flagged in the media as a possibility of a point of care diagnostics that we can take to wherever the patient is. And because we've made novel software as well as hardware, put it in the phone, the patients can use it wherever they are and be able to get results. Or if it's the results don't necessarily go to the patients themselves, they are sent to the doctor via cloud, and the doctor can then inform the patient what to do. So that's the research that we are pushing. The research is also applicable in pharmaceuticals. Why pharmaceuticals? When I had a sit down with one of the CEOs of a pharmaceutical company here in South Africa, they informed me that one of the biggest problems in Africa and in South Africa is that of substandard medication. And as you can see, I mean, I was taken aback to see statements like this, where one in 10 medical products is actually a substandard or a falsified product. So this is a big problem because obviously, there's people that are also on ARVs, and we're also noticing that ARVs that are taken in different areas in the world are different. So we then decided, okay, we can use photonics to actually interrogate what the molecular composition of pills is, and we can make some form of bulk screening diagnostics that can be put in entry ports within our country, be it the airport or the seaport, to do screening of drugs before they come in and get dispatched wherever their final destination is. So that's the work that we are doing in our one of our photonics labs and in one of our photonics setups. We've got a very high profile microscope that has been built with our own chemical sensors as well, novel chemical sensors that allows us to be able to tell what the composition of medicines is. Another big problem is where you find in other African countries where, they also have markets where they are selling medication. And you can imagine medication is like the food that we eat. How we store it is very important. If medication is going to be stored in a place like this, where potentially there is the risk of sunlight shining on it, and just interacting with some of the active pharmaceutical ingredients and rendering them useless at the end of the day, and also the term in terms of seeing if the medication is expired or not. So we have an issue where there's still problems like this, and then also in African cultures, there's a lot of consultation with traditionalists or traditional healers that can also administer medication. So we are starting to talk with some of those people to see if we can actually also help them to classify what's in the mixtures that they give to their patients, so that at least everybody knows what they are taking. So that's the work that we do when it comes to substandard medication and different types of medication. Photonics also has got a very big role in agriculture. In South Africa, especially in the previous few years, we've had a problem with electricity. And problems with electricity often also lead to problems with water. So just by foresight, we started thinking, we need to make application of our research also in the agriculture space, where we do food safety as well as food security research. So we are not only using photonics, but it's in tandem with the likes of machine learning, artificial intelligence, and it's all built inbuilt with our photonics technologies. So that's the work that we are doing. So in terms of my message to the audience, you know, I just want to say, and this might be sounding cliche, but I found it's actually very applicable in my life. You know, I never allowed anyone to define my limits, even those that told me you'll never do physics because it's not for people like you. It never deterred me. You know, only you can tell how far you can stretch or how high you can bounce. It's only you that can make that decision. So never ever allow anybody to box you or to tell you you can go this far, you can't go. Don't even listen to it. Refuse. Okay. And then the second piece of advice that I'd like to share with the audience is that develop good relationships. I don't know about people in other spheres, but definitely in STEM, especially in South Africa, because, you know, the fields are so niche and they are so small and everybody knows everybody else. You know, you might separate with someone and go your separate ways today, but definitely goodbyes in this field are not permanent. Your roads will always, or your paths will always cross in the field of STEM. So develop good relationships with people and be a good person yourself. You know, don't burn bridges. And then the other thing is help. I've seen help comes from unexpected places. Okay. So keep your mind open. You know, don't doubt sometimes when somebody has a good offer for you. And I'm not talking like job offers but if somebody is offering collaboration, you know, I find in our spaces sometimes we are inclined to working in silos. I don't like that because, you know, you never know where your help might come from. So just open your mind and try different things. Of course, within limits and within, you know, hierarchies and within structures, within policy, but allow yourself to be adaptable because you never know where your next big opportunity may lie, okay? So that's the advice I always give myself, to just keep an open mind. And don't be mad for a long time, you know? Yes, you can be mad because you are human, but don't let it consume you. And then for me, there's nothing like a glass ceiling. You know, I've worked for CSIR, as I said, 30 years this October, and I'm still happy at the CSIR. I mean, I'm not saying that I will die at the CSIR. I'm not one to cling to places and to cling to people, but I also know that there's nothing in my vocabulary as a glass ceiling because my work is also so diverse. You know, I get to do different things. You know, I go on conferences, I work as a reviewer for different scientific writings, scientific write-ups, I participate as a lecturer at university, you know, so there's just so much. And the work that I do, the research that I do itself, there is just so much innovation that I will never wake up one day and find myself bored. So for me, there's nothing like a glass ceiling in STEM. I really don't believe in it, but that's because how I have wired my mind. All right, so that's just my piece of advice. This is my team. This is my current team. That's me there, and that's the rest of them. Some of them are PhD students, some of them are master's students, some of them are senior researchers, and some have started with me from 2015. We've been working together. I think Sat even started working with me around 2012. So, you know, and I've seen these people, some of them grow from coming into the group just as an honors student, and now they are senior researchers in the group. So, you know, when you grow, it's also important to grow with others in your life. I'm very much a Christian, and this is one of the scriptures in Isaiah 61:3 that I really love, because it shows, it's sometimes it actually resonates very closely with me, because it shows from where God took me and where God is taking me. You know, it says, "I will give you beauty to replace your ashes." I really love this piece. And with that, I'd love to thank the audience for listening to me and for the opportunity to talk this afternoon.